Hello, it's Carrie here, and I am having another celebration week because the Female Entrepreneur Association has turned 10, which is crazy. I mean, this 10 past 10 years has just flown by so quickly. And so I wanted to make this episode to share my 10 top lessons with you that I have learned over the past 10 years of building FEA. But before I get into that, I just wanted to share that we are doing a giveaway again this week. I would love your help and support to share this podcast on the Shimi's Business Show with people that you think might like it. So if you take a picture of yourself listening to this episode and you tag us on your stories on Instagram, tag us at Female Entrepreneur Association, you will be in with a chance of winning something amazing. So definitely head over to our Instagram account and check out what the giveaway is and get involved, because it would really mean the world to me to get your support in getting more people to discover the Shimi's Business Show. These past 10 years have been amazing and such an adventure. So many ups, so many downs. And I feel like I've just learned so much throughout my journey of building FEA. And I'm really excited to share these 10 things with you. Because when I started FEA, I had never built a community before. I'd never done anything like it before. Like, I started FEA because I had another online business that was successful, but I felt so lonely. And that's why I really wanted to build a platform to bring women together. And also back then, there was literally nothing for women. And if there was something for women, it was like a man had created it because it felt so masculine. And I was just like, I want something fun. I want something that feels like pretty and exciting. That being said, what I was creating in the beginning definitely was ugly. I was no graphic designer, that's for sure. Building FEA, had so much imposter syndrome. I came up with the idea 3 years before having the guts to finally do something about it. I didn't make money for the first 2 years because I was thinking that if I charged for it, that it would derail my mission, and that how could I possibly charge people for just helping and trying to inspire them? And I felt all sorts of weirdness because my first business was phone unlock code. So it was like, okay, people are paying to get their phone unlocked. It's a service. It's not the same as me sharing something from my heart and expecting to get paid for that. So I just had like a lot of weird mindset blocks around that. But you know, throughout it all, it's just been a case of following my heart, following my dreams, and just staying true to that. It's helped me to make it what it is today. And, you know, it's a multiple seven-figure business. I've been able to write Shimi's Business, which is a best-selling book. We've got our membership, which has got over 5,000 amazing women involved from all over the world. And that's just been absolutely incredible to build that community and that space to help women to turn their ideas into successful businesses. You know, I think of like Inspired Vacay, our events, and like all the fun stuff that we've done along the way, and even the Carrie & Co. product range with our annual planners and our notebooks and our manifesting pens and all that stuff. Like all the fun things that I've done over this 10 years, it's just been so incredible to take my ideas and to see if I can bring them into reality and I can actually create something with my ideas. It's just been so fun to experiment and to give myself permission to dream big and then go for it. Because in doing that, I've been able to just achieve the most incredible things. So over this 10 years, these are my top 10 lessons for you. So my first lesson, and this is the biggest lesson for me when I was starting FEA, was you have to go all in and commit to your vision, commit to your dreams. You know, so for me, like I said, I had the idea for this platform for female entrepreneurs 3 years before I did anything about it. And I dabbled. I bought domain names. I set up websites. I dabbled. But I never fully went all in. I teetered on the edge of this idea. I never fully committed. But in 2011, I decided I was going to go all in and I was going to commit. And that commitment changed literally everything. I got so fed up of just not making progress and going in circles. And I remember reading the E-Myth Revisited revisited by Michael Gerber again, and he has this chapter on primary aims and this exercise on it being your own funeral and what would people be saying about the kind of life you've lived, the kind of things you've achieved. And I was like, oh my gosh, like I need to stop going in circles. I'm not living the life I want to live. I'm not achieving the things I want to achieve. And I realized that the only way to achieve those things and to actually build the business of my dreams was to commit and to go all in. So I did. I went all in, and it was like a full like body and soul thing. Like I just felt it in every cell of my being that this is what I'm going to do. I am going to stick to it. Because before that, like I had the idea for the Female Entrepreneur Association, but I was also had my phone unlocking business. I also had a business-to-business telecoms business. I also had this idea to create this ad agency, which I'd bought a domain name for and set up a website called AdPulse. And like all these different things. And I was like, idea, 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 idea. And I was hopping from one thing to the next and never fully going all in on it. And so when I was like, scrap the rest of it, that is not lighting me up. Let's go with this idea that is lighting me up. When I did that and I went all in, it was like I sat on my desk and it was like, oh, like I can just focus on this one thing. And it just felt so much lighter and easier because I knew what my focus was. I knew it was figuring out how I could make it a success. So commit, go all in with your idea and your dreams, like really, truly commit to it. And don't commit to like every single one, commit to one and go for it. Like never before, like literally for me, that's what got me off the starting block and helped me to really make progress. And I've really kind of stuck with that as I've built FEA with all my ideas, like even the book. It took me bloody years, but I just kind of stayed committed to the idea of actually doing it, even though I didn't know how when I had so many ups and downs within. It took me years. I just stayed committed to it. So commit, go all in. Okay, the second biggest lesson is that you really have to just trust yourself. I remember at the beginning of the Female Entrepreneur Association, people would literally say to me, what are you doing? This doesn't make sense. I would have like meetings with people and they just wouldn't get what I was trying to do. They wouldn't get my vision. I remember someone actually literally told me like, you don't have a, something like, I wasn't financially savvy and what the heck was I doing just offering everything for free and not charging for anything, and that it was never going to work. It wasn't a viable business. And I think sometimes we can get so sucked in by what other people are telling us, but we have to trust ourselves. Like you have to trust yourself. You have to trust your vision, because if you don't, you're going to get knocked off track by other people telling you that you're doing something wrong or that it should be this way or it should be that way. Like, you know the way. You, your soul, your heart, you know the way. I really believe that. In the first few years of building FEA, all I was focused on was building my audience. And I knew if I could build an audience of people that loved what FEA was about, that stood for the same things, that were passionate about turning their ideas into successful businesses, I knew that somehow I would be able to make it work and it would become incredibly successful. So that is what I focused on. I wasn't focused on how can I build an audience and make money and do all these things. I just focused on getting myself out there, getting the word out there and starting to build momentum, build this movement, build the community. And I knew that's what I needed to do for the type of business I was building. And so when people came to me and were like, you don't know what you're doing, I was like, yes, I do know what I'm doing. And I do have a plan and I'm sticking to my plan. And okay, yes, I had money blocks and other stuff, but like my plan worked. I was doing something that I knew would work. So trust yourself. Trust yourself. Like, honestly, you are the voice you should be listening to. Okay, so my third biggest lesson is not making money doesn't mean you're failing. And this kind of links in with the fact that for the first largely 2 years of building FEA, I didn't really make anything. Probably in the first 18 months of FEA, I made less than probably $2,000. So literally, in the grand scheme of things, I really didn't make very much. And people, you know, might have said, you know, what are you doing? I mean, I'm pretty sure at one point my mum probably did say, don't you think you should just go and get a job now? A proper job. And I remember actually somebody offering me a job for a lot of money and I turned it down. It was such a great opportunity. And at this point, FEA wasn't making any money. And so I was like, do I take this job and know it's guaranteed income, or do I keep pursuing this dream I've got even though I'm not making any money yet? And I turned down the job and I carried on with FEA. Thank goodness, because I just trusted and I believed that somehow I would figure it out. But the point is that so many people give up after 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, 18 months, 2 years, because they're not making money or they're not making the money they want to be making. And you see other people being like, I made 30,000 in 30 days, or I made seven figures in 1 year. And you think, bloody hell, like, I'm failing then because I'm literally making nothing. I've been doing this for a year and I've made nothing. You think, oh my gosh, there's something wrong here. But actually, what if there's not something wrong? What if you are on the right tracks? Not making money doesn't mean you are failing. It just means you're still on that journey of figuring out how you're going to do it, how you're going to scale it. And like I said, for me, like, I literally made less than $2,000 in those first 18 months. And has FBA failed? No, it hasn't. But I literally had to stay, keep the faith that I would figure out. And I had a quote on my wall that said, successful people hang on when everyone else has let go. And I'd look at that quote and I'd think, if there's one thing you can do, when you can hang on to this dream, hang on to this vision, hang on to this mission, and just keep taking that next little step and that next little step and that next little step, and you will figure it out. So just because, if you're not making money yet, if you aren't making money, it doesn't mean you're failing. Or if you're not making enough money yet, if you're not making the six figures and seven figures and whatever else that people like spew out, it doesn't matter. It does not matter. This is your journey and it's absolutely amazing as it is. And you will get there as long as you keep going. Okay, so my fourth biggest lesson is this. It can be messy. It can be chaotic. You can be ridiculously unorganized. You can be up, you can be down, you can be all over the place, and you can still build a wildly successful business. Perfection is absolutely not required to build a successful business. I found that the most liberating thing of building a business. Like, honestly, I think sometimes, probably because of social media, you just see everyone's like front of house. Like, you don't see the behind the mess scenes, which is where the mess is at. You just see the picture of perfection and you think, oh my gosh, like, this person has it all figured out and everything's just amazing. And it makes you feel so inadequate and so inferior about yourself, because you realize that on your side, you're looking at all this crap and thinking, oh my gosh, like, I'm never going to make this work because I'm never going to be that perfect. I'm never going to be that good. You know, but I love the fact that, like, I am a messy, unorganized, chaotic person. Like, I am like that most of the time. I'm all over the place. I doubt myself. I question myself. I overthink everything. I still have feelings that I'm not worthy enough. I still struggle at the idea of creating new things because I think that it won't be worth it. And I worry that people won't buy it. I still think those things now. And I realize you can still think those things. You can be messy. You can be unorganized. You can be so far from perfect. And you can still create so much success. And I think that is bloody amazing. I just, honestly, the most liberating thing, you just got to keep going just as you are, because you are literally perfect as you are. So just keep going with how you're going and just be you. And that is okay. You don't have to have it all figured out and to be perfectly organized and systemized to create success. So that leads me onto my next lesson, which is, while perfection isn't required, showing up is very much required. So when you have an idea, you have a dream to grow a business, to start a business, you have to show up for it, because no one else is going to show up for your dreams and ideas other than you. So you have to actually get yourself out there. You have to be willing to get out of your own way to actually take the steps you need to take in order to make the progress you want to make, in order to get to the finishing line, to create the success you want, to create the financial abundance and that it have the impact that you want to have. And this, I think, is probably one of the hardest lessons of all, is how to actually get out of your own way and show up. I know for me, this has been like my biggest battle. I still get in my own way, like I just said, all the time. So it's not that you're not allowed to get in your own way. It's just you have to know how to get out of your own way. That's the key. Like, I know that I struggle with imposter syndrome. I know I struggle with these feelings that I'm not good enough. And they probably stem from when I was a kid and failing at school so much. But I also recognize that I have to do certain things to get out of my own way. Like for me, one of the biggest things is this vision that I have of knowing that we live on this planet that hovers in blackness in this universe that we don't even understand, yet somehow we are here experiencing life and we have all these opportunities in front of us. And it makes me think, like, why the hell should I just not go for this? Because, like, this is my one life and I want to make it amazing. And it doesn't matter if I mess up or if I fail. Like, what matters is that I tried. And so that thought in itself helps me to show up and to keep showing up over and over and over again. So it's like finding different things, like different tools. I mean, I've made so many videos on like how to get out of your own way, how to really truly step into your, to become like the most powerful person you can, in the sense of like overcoming your fears and having the courage to chase after your dreams in a big way. I've made so many videos on that. I'll leave it in the show notes for you. But I just think it's really about learning how you can show up in the most powerful way to get your voice, your vision, your message, your business, your brand out there so that you can create success. So my sixth lesson is that you really have to create awareness for yourself around what's working and what's not working. I've found that when you're building a business, if you lack awareness, you are going to probably run yourself into the ground. And what I mean is that, like, when you're building a business, everything is an experiment. Like, you don't know what's going to work and what's not. You don't know what the best opt-in page is going to be. You don't know what the best way to convert your audience and to become a customer is going to be. Like, you don't know that stuff. You only know it by experimenting and testing and testing and testing and testing. But if you don't have awareness, you really fall down. So you have to get into the habit of creating awareness around what's working, what's not working, what is going on here, and tuning in with yourself and how you feel and what is happening, so that you can start to make it better. And you make little tweaks, little tweaks, little tweaks, little tweaks. Because, for example, like when I started FEA and I wasn't making any money for those first 2 years, what I did know is that I was creating momentum because my audience was growing. I was getting really positive feedback. I felt really good in myself. I felt like I was making progress. Even though I wasn't financially, I was making progress in other ways. And so I knew I was onto something. I could feel like I even had like multiple articles written about me in newspapers. And so I knew I was onto something. So I knew I just had to keep going. But I see some people who do things and they do the same things over and over and over again, and it is not working. And it's like, open your eyes and recognize it's not working. And that's the hard thing. So you have to have awareness of what's going on. It's not a problem if something's not working, because let's face it, when you're building a business, the majority of things probably aren't going to work. Like, there's going to be loads of things that don't work, but you have to have awareness that it's not working so that you can course correct and figure out, well, what's the right step to take? What's the next step to take? What's the next step I can try? Because if you're not at that level of thinking, then you keep going on, going round and round and round in circles, getting the same crappy, crappy, crappy results. And then you don't create success. So I think with Albert Einstein that says you can't solve a problem from the same level of thinking that you had when it was created. And it's like, you have to create awareness so that you can look at things and make better decisions to help you to build your business and have success. So awareness around what's working, what's not working, and really becoming that experimenter, that little detective in your business that's going to look at things and see, like, little tweak, you know, what tweaks can we make to create growth, really. And I found that when I step into that person, that I can make amazing things happen, little step by little step by little step, fine-tuning the business. Like, that's what we have to do. And that's, like, for me, been such a big lesson. Otherwise, you can do the wrong thing for months and months and months and months. And there's probably been times when I've done the wrong thing for way longer than I care to admit. And that is honestly why it's so important to create awareness. Okay, so my seventh lesson is that you really need to tune in and listen to yourself, and you have to create space for this. Sometimes I feel like we're just going and going and going and doing it and doing it and doing it, that we get so caught up in the weeds that we're not even listening to ourselves anymore. We're not hearing our voice. We don't hear the way from within. We're hearing the way someone else is telling us to go, but that might not be our way. You know, I don't know about you, but like, I literally was scrolling through on Instagram before and I was like, someone told me that funnels don't work, and someone else telling me that emails marketing doesn't work anymore, that email is dead, and then someone else is telling me that you don't need a niche, and you know it's not about your audience, and you hear people saying all these things, and that might be true for them, but it might not be true for me, because actually I don't believe in those things. So I think it's like we get inundated with information from this person saying, do it this way, do it this way, do it this way. No, do it your way. That is what the most important thing is. You have to listen to yourself, because this is about you. This is about your ideas, your dreams, your vision. You have to do it your way. You have to have the courage to blaze your own trail. And sometimes that means like just ignoring, silencing the noise around you. You know, for example, like if you listen to people, I personally switch off from people that tell me it's like this, and if you don't do it my way, then it's not going to work. Like, I just don't like that, because there isn't one way. Like, it's different for all of us. So I just switch off from those people that dictate to me, like, it's not about this, it's about this. Like, I tune out, because sometimes they can make it so convincing and you feel so convinced that they're right. And then you're like, oh, well, they said it, they must be right. And then you're like, the next thing you're thinking that funnels don't work anymore and you can't ever make money in funnels because blah, blah, blah said this, that's why funnels don't work. And you think, well, I better scrap my whole funnels, you know? Whereas actually funnels, you might have been making loads of progress, and for you and your business and how you feel, it could have been a really good fit, but you didn't listen to that inner knowing that you had. You listen to that person saying, no, don't do funnels. And I'll give you an example of this, actually. In my business a few years ago, I had this realization that I needed to do evergreen. And someone said to me, no, evergreen doesn't work. You can never make it work. And I listened to them. Over listening to I knew in myself that's what I needed to do. And I listened to someone else. And we've come full circle. And now I'm doing evergreen. So you have to listen to yourself, which is easier said than done. But what I have learned in this whole experience of building businesses is that, you know, it's your journey and your adventure, and you might take some wrong turns and whatnot. But, and I'm not saying don't learn from other people, don't listen to other people. Yes, learn from other people, listen to other people, but bring it back to you. And what seems right to you, what feels good to you, what sits well with you. And if something doesn't sit well with you, then just ignore it. And that is how you create your way. And when I say create space for this, I mean like make time to like go out for a walk where you can just tune in with your thoughts and yourself, or take time to journal where you can ask yourself like, how am I feeling? What's going on? Or for example, like if you are stuck on a particular area and you're not quite sure like what you should focus on, journal about it, or you know, just sit and think about it. You know, create the space for yourself to tune in, to get inspired, to hear your inner voice. It's talking to you all the time. You're getting these little nuggets coming into you all the time, but so often we're not paying attention to them, we're not hearing them, we're not listening to them, because we're just so in the weeds of doing it, listen to that person, listen to that person, listen to that person. We just don't listen to ourselves. Listen to yourself. Your voice is the most powerful voice you can ever listen to. You need to listen to yourself. You really do know the way. And it's just so important to remember that. And if you take piece from someone else and a piece from someone else and a piece from someone else, great, but then make it your piece and fit it inside your own jigsaw puzzle. And like I said, there is no right or wrong way. So if someone is telling you, you categorically have to do it like this, be like, no, thank you. That's your way, which is great for you, but I'll do things my way. Thank you very much. Just do that. And I found in doing that, it's really helped me to just set a different standard for myself. Okay, so the eighth lesson is you don't have to do all of the things. You really don't. And it's really funny because talking about my previous point, I think it was yesterday I was listening to an interview on a podcast and the piece of advice was, so basically don't just focus on marketing yourself on one platform, focus on marketing yourself on all of the platforms. If you are resenting your customers, it's because you need more customers and it's not good enough just to be on one platform, you need to be on more. And I was like, okay. I thought, I'll pass on that. But I've realized that you don't need to do all the things. What is more, what I found to be much more productive and also get a much more successful result is just focusing on like one thing. Whether it's marketing and social media, like pick one platform that you can focus on and work on and just go all in on that one platform. And once you're doing really good on that platform, you're getting results on that platform, then maybe you could look at like, okay, is there another platform that I can utilize? But I just think that we feel like, and I know the same thing, like when I first started FEA, I was doing all the things. And I sometimes think there's a place for doing all the things. Maybe at the beginning when you're experimenting, you're like trying to figure out what is going to work the best, what is going to get you the most momentum. So yes, experiment a little bit, but then go all in on one thing. So for me, I experimented and I got myself out there and then I went all in on Facebook and it really paid off because it really helped me to figure out how to have a breakthrough, because then all I was thinking was, how can I figure out how to become amazing at marketing on Facebook? How can I do that? So when I woke up in the morning, I was figuring out how can I become amazing at marketing on Facebook. I wasn't trying to figure out how I'm going to be amazing on Twitter and LinkedIn and all these other platforms. I was just focusing on Facebook. So it helped me to like have breakthroughs so much faster. And I built so much momentum, which really had a huge impact on the growth of FEA. So you don't have to do all the things. And I think when you do try and do all the things, it just gets so bloody overwhelming. You just can't keep up. So make it easy on yourself. Like, what is one thing that you could be focused on that will get you a bigger result? And do that one thing. Like, where are you getting the results? Like, if you took all your activities that you do and you made a note over, like, say, a week, you tracked your time, like, out of the things you did, what are the things that actually got you a result? The most important things to focus on. Like, what are those things? Focus on that, or the one thing that comes up as the biggest thing to focus on. Like, you don't have to be doing all the other little bits. I think we sometimes waste so much time just doing stuff that we don't need to be doing. That is slowing us down from creating the progress that we want. So yeah, you don't have to do all the things. You don't have to be on every social media platform. You don't have to have a front end offer and a back and five back end offers. And you don't have to have this package and this package and this package. Like, I have recently been speaking to a lot of people because for me, building FEA, my one offering was the members club and is the members club. And that was all there was. And I just focused on that. And so many people were like, you need back-end offers, you need this, you need that. And I'm like, no, I just need to figure out how I can make the Members Club a real success. And in doing that, it's become one of the most successful online memberships. And we've got over 5,000 paying members. It's incredibly successful. And I spoke to a guy, well, I was in a mastermind recently, and there was a guy in there talking about his membership. And he has got 30,000 members now. And someone asked, what other offers do you have? And he says, I don't. It's just the membership. That's it. And I was like, thank you, because so often we just hear people being like, you need this and this and this and this and this, and you don't. You really don't. You could just have one offer that just works really well, and you just focus on how can I get this to scale, and that's all you focus on. So you don't have to be doing everything. Just keep it simple for yourself, and I honestly just think that is the best way. Okay, so my ninth lesson is really around building your audience. Like, one, it is so unbelievably important that you proactively build an audience of people, but you want to focus on building an audience of people that love your business, love your brand, love what it's all about. Like, it's better to have quality over quantity when it comes to audience. But the most important thing is that you focus on actually building your audience, because, I mean, for all of us building businesses, one of the biggest things we've got to do is get discovered so that people actually want to engage with us and then want to buy from us. So how are you proactively building that audience? And for me, in the first 2 years, that's really all I was focused on, is figuring out how do I build an audience of people that love what FEA stands for and what FEA is about and want to be part of it. And in doing that, it's really helped me to create so much success. And now, you know, when you've got an email list of people that are paying attention and love what you say and love what you share, like, it's just such an incredible asset. So for example, a couple of years ago, or I can't remember exactly when it was, but I had a membership course that I'd created as a bonus for something. And I thought, you know what, maybe there'll be people on the email list that want this. So I put a couple of emails, I think maybe there was like 4 or 5 emails that went out over a 5-day period. And we had a couple of ads running that I think we spent $2,500 to $3,000 on ads. And we made over $100,000. Just from putting out a few emails. Last year, I put out 2 emails for this promotion that I was part of, and it made $65,000. 2 emails. It was just one day, one the next. $65,000. I didn't do anything else. I just sent 2 emails. So for me, having my audience, building my email list, building my social media, having that presence, that awareness has been like so powerful. And I know it's different for all of our different types of businesses, but every single business all of us have an audience. All of us have people who are going to buy from us. So how are you proactively growing your audience, and what are you doing to focus on that, creating that awareness? And so for me, it's like been the biggest lesson is like, really focus on creating that awareness and focus on building an audience that really loves the brand. And I've done, again, so many videos on this that I can link to in the show notes around like building a brand that people love, building a brand that stands for something. Like, what do you stand for? How are people going to love you over someone else? So I think it's just really making sure that you're clear on one, quality over quantity, and creating an engaging connection with you and your audience. You will thank yourself later on for doing it. It'll be one of the most powerful things you do as you build your business. Okay, so my 10th and final lesson is this. It is to keep your offers simple and doable. So throughout FEA, whenever I have had, like, actually, at the beginning, I found it really overwhelming, the idea of like actually creating something to sell. I didn't know where to begin, and I was always trying to create the big thing. And what I realized was that it's better just to create something and keep it really simple and get it out there than to create some massive thing, which is why I ended up creating my membership and just created 1 month's worth of content and then put it out there so that it was simple, it was doable, I could get it up and off the ground. So I think when it comes to creating your offers, where, you know, your offers for people to buy, make it as simple and easy as possible. So often I hear people who want to create courses, for example, and they want to create these huge courses and they're so overwhelmed and it feels so heavy because it's like this big course is about this and this and this and this and all the things, and they don't know where to begin, and it just never gets off the ground because it's so overwhelming. So like, look at your offers and think, how can I create something that's just simple and easy to do and get out there, and do it, make it simple, easy and doable. And that is like how you can build momentum with it. So, and it's even the same for freebies. I remember for ages being like, what freebie should I create? I don't know how to create a freebie. And then one day I just sat down and I was like, it was March, and I was like, I haven't achieved what I want to do this year. So I created this like little goal plan for myself to make March amazing and to achieve a really big goal by the end of March. And I was like, other people might want to do this with me. And then I turned it into a little freebie that people could download and do it with me. And it just became simple and easy and doable and not complicated. And so I think with your offers, whether they're free, you know, freebies or paid offers, things that you're selling, just keep it so simple and so doable, and don't overwhelm yourself thinking that it needs to be some humongous thing. Because I think the other thing is that I suffer from this, is that we think that to make it valuable, we need to keep adding more and more and more and more and more. But the reality is, when we create stuff that is simple, people like it more and people get more from it. So just keep what you're creating simple and easy to put out there. So if you've got an idea for a coaching program or an online course or even a product, how could you create something super simple? Even if you create it as a minimum viable product, like what would that look like? How could you make it the simplest version of itself so that you can create it and get it out there? Because I think if we look at like the big thing that we want to create, that's when we stop ourselves from actually creating it because it's too much of a beast to attack. Like, so break it all down and make it so simple and easy to create and see progress and momentum, and build it that way. I found that throughout FEA, it's been one little step at a time, one little step, one little step, one little step. And all those tiny little steps have led to the success that, you know, that it is today. So yes, know that it's all about taking those little tiny, teeny tiny little steps that are simple and doable. So when you look at your plan for the day, you think, what simple and doable things can I do today that can help me to create my offers and to build, you know, build something wildly successful. So those are my 10 things. I feel like I could sit and go on and talk about this, you know, on and on and on, because there are just so many things that I've learned throughout the years of building FEA, but I've got so many episodes that you can go back on that will help you with, you know, really building your business. There's my book, She Means Business. If you haven't read it, definitely check it out. There's so many bonuses that go with it, and it's really how I've built my business and really how you can, the framework for building a successful online business with a 28-day She Means Business Challenge at the end. So definitely check that out. But yes, we've got so many resources. If you're not part of the membership, then come and check that out. We are such an amazing online community of women who are following their dreams, and we'd love to have you if you're not part of it. But yeah, it's been an amazing wild journey over these past 10 years, and it just blows me away to think that I've taken my teeny tiny idea that was in my head when I had so many doubts, so many worries, so much imposter syndrome, and to go from that to have made millions and millions from my teeny tiny crazy ideas just blows me away. And it makes me realize that so much is possible for every single one of us. You can create so much success. You have your ideas, your dreams, your visions, your voice for a reason, and you need to use it and just take the tiny little step, tiny little step, tiny little step towards making those dreams your reality. And if you just keep going and you keep the faith, you can create something so amazing. And just think of where you could be in 10 years. Like, think of what you could have achieved and what you could have accomplished. And if I can do it, and, you know, especially having made less than $2,000 in the first 18 months, then we can all do it. We can all create so much success. Well, thank you so much for joining me for this episode. I hope you've enjoyed listening to my 10 lessons. We'll have so many more behind the scenes and exciting things going on over on Instagram. So head on over and check it out if you're not over there following us already at Female Entrepreneur Association. And I will see you next week for another episode of the She Means Business Show. I hope you loved this week's episode of the She Means Business Show. If you want more help and support to build a wildly successful business, then join hundreds of thousands of women and become an FEA insider. You'll get access to some of our amazing freebies, to our bonuses, to our giveaways, to so much good stuff. Head over to femaleentrepreneurassociation.com/insider to get all of the goodness. And I will see you next week for another episode of the She Means Business Show.